In beer, we have four main components: water, malt, hops, and yeast. In malt, we get most of our main components we're going to use to create the beer: carbohydrates, proteins, and some lipids. With our proteins, we have a macromolecule made of small amino acid groups. The amino acid groups are connected with amide bonds, or often referred to as peptide bonds when we're dealing with biochemistry or protein chemistry. If we look at the structure, we see that we have a carbonyl attached to a nitrogen. This is the amide bond. This amide bond is the peptide backbone of a protein. Proteins are made of multiple amino acids connected by these amide bonds. Well, if we look at amino acid, notice it has several components. First, we have the acid moiety, or a carboxylic acid. We have an amino group, an NH2, and we will have some type of side group. There are 20 naturally known amino acids, so this R group on the side varies between each of those amino acids. Now, the way it's shown here is actually not correct for physiological chemistry. What we often see is the zitter ion. So if we're dealing with near neutral pHs, we actually have the carboxylic acid as the carboxylate, and we have the amino as the ammonium, or the protonated nitrogen. If we look here, here is one of our characteristic amino acids that's very important in brewing: valine. Valine has our carboxylic acid, it's got our amino group, and it has this isopropyl group. This creates the amino acid. Now, valine is very important because it is used to eliminate diacetyl by yeast. So having the right amount of amino acids is very important. The other thing we need to talk about with proteins is their overall structure. Turns out that protein structure is essential to not only the activity, but the process that we see with proteins. We have four levels of structure: primary, secondary, tertiary, and quaternary. Let's look at these four. In primary, this is just which amino acid is attached to which amino acid. So if we think about it, we have a long chain, kind of like a necklace, where we have different types of beads connected. The way these are connected is our primary structure. So amino acid 1 connected to amino acid 2 connected to amino acid 3, just in a linear chain. This is our primary structure. If we think about our secondary structure, we start to bring in interactions between these amino acid groups. Two interactions, or two shapes, start to form: alpha helix and beta sheets. We see these starting to form, and this gives us the interaction between the amino acid groups to give us this secondary structure. When we look at the tertiary structure, at this point we're getting to the full three-dimensional structure of a single protein molecule. As we can see here, we have alpha amylase. The alpha amylase is going to be important in the breakdown of our carbohydrate, amylose. Here we have a protein that is going to be the enzyme and is essential to create the maltose that we're going to need in the fermentation process. The quaternary structure is when we have more than one protein. So if we bring in multiple proteins, they then form an aggregate, and this aggregate would be a quaternary structure. So if we have a single protein chain, we only can get to tertiary structure and not quaternary. What are the importance of these structures? The simple primary structure just gives us the chain. Secondary structure, we start to see some of the shape. And then the tertiary structure, that's where we start to get our three-dimensional shape. This three-dimensional shape is essential in our enzyme. So if we look at our enzyme activity, and here we have the structure of beta amylose, another enzyme that's going to be important in breaking down our carbohydrates to our smaller sugars that we'll be able to ferment with the yeast. This enzyme is from our protein. So there's two things that occur with our proteins. One is proteinase. We're just going to be breaking down those proteins into their amino acids. These amino acids are going to be essential for the yeast to produce other yeast and to grow. The other thing that the proteins are going to create from the barley when it's malted is these enzymes. These enzymes are essential to the further process that we'll see in the mash and that we'll see with yeast. Now, when we think about enzymes, remember that the structure is essential. We can change this structure by changing a few simple characteristics. One of those is temperature. One of the reasons that we don't take our malted barley, throw it into water, and boil it right away is that if we do that, we'll take our protein that's now our enzyme and we will denature our enzyme. What happens in denaturing is we take this three-dimensional structure that is our enzyme and we break down that structure. In the case of heat, we add enough energy to overcome the intermolecular interactions between the different parts of the protein to break apart that. We can think about it, if we have a ball, if we add heat, it just starts to expand out. It no longer has a shape, and without shape, it does not have its activity. So if we take our malted barley, add it to water, and boil it right away, we're not going to give time for those enzymes that we've activated to react with a carbohydrate, because by going over their optimum temperature, we're going to denature those enzymes. If we look at our proteins give us the building blocks that yeasts are going to need to grow so that we can get a nice, full primary fermentation, but they're also going to give us the enzymes that are essential in the conversion of carbohydrates to the formidable sugars that we turn into ethanol.